أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ولقد كتبنا في الزبور من بعد الذكر أن الأرض يرثها عبادي الصالحون إن في هذا لبلاغا لقوم عابدين وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين قل إنما يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فهل أنتم مسلمون فإن تولوا فقل آذنتكم على سواء وإن أدري أقريب أم بعيد ما يوعدون إنه يعلم الجهر من القول ويعلم ما تكتمون وإن أدري لعله فتنة لكم ومتاع إلى حين قال رب احكم بالحق قال رب احكم بالحق وربنا الرحمن المستعان على ما تصفون صدق الله العظيم.
طالع البدر علينا من ثنيات الوداع وجب الشكر علينا ما دعا لله داعي ما دعا لله داعي أيها المبعوث بالأمر المطاع جئت شرفت العوالم مرحبا يا خير داعي مرحبا يا خير داعي طالع البدر اصطفانا نورك الغالي أضاء رغم أنف الملحدين فيضه عام ما البقاع فيضه عام البقاع طالع البدر
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I now declare the Zaytuna College commencement begun. Please be seated. Alhamdulillah. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina wa Habibina Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa man wala wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Alhamdulillah. Today is an auspicious day for most Muslims. This is the Nusf Sha'ban. Ramadan is almost here for us, so it's a blessed day to be graduating. The day also marks our third graduating class and our 6 years of completion here at Zaytuna. So we began as a small school, and we still have relatively small classes, but we always opted for quality over quantity. We're living in the age of quantity, and a lot of quality has been taken out, not only of our societies, but even out of our families, out of our entertainment, out of our educational system itself. One of the important aspects of any society is the concept of freedom. And freedom is certainly, if you asked people in this country to define really what makes America America, I think many of them would say it's the idea of freedom, that people here breathe freely, home of the of land of the free and home of the brave. This is embedded in the American psyche, but one of the things that we learn here is defining terms. It's very important to define a term so that you understand what it means, because we use language, but very often we're unaware of the implications of the actual words that we're using and what they mean. If you open up any dictionary, very often you will see numbers in the definition, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, because words don't just mean one thing, they mean several things very often. And understanding the context of a word and its usage is a very important science in the tradition of Islam called ilm al-wada. In fact, Bernard Weiss, great Orientalist, American Orientalist, said it was a unique contribution of the Muslim civilization to introduce this knowledge, this specific knowledge, into the world. So very briefly, I really want to talk about the concept of freedom and how it relates to liberal arts. Because liberal is not political liberal, it's not feeling the burn. Liberal arts is an education that was traditionally designed for free people. The other educational systems were considered servile arts. They called them the illiberal arts because you were a means to somebody else's end. So you learn how to fix a car. Somebody wants, the end is to fix his car. He goes to a mechanic who is his means to completing that end. But a liberal arts education is not designed to make you a means. It's designed to fulfill or help you fulfill your end. What is your purpose as a human being? Some philosophers have divided freedom into different types of freedom. One of them is circumstantial freedom. That's the idea that I think is very prevalent in the United States, the idea that we're free to go where we want to and to do what we want to, as long as we don't harm, according to John Stuart Mill, in his harm principle, as long as we don't harm anybody else. But there's another type of freedom which is at the root of a liberal arts education, and that is called acquired freedom. Not circumstantial freedom, but acquired freedom. It's the freedom to move towards self-perfection. If you look, and just to give you an analogy, if you take an instrument like the piano, if a child goes up to a piano, it pounds on it and it makes horrible sounds. That's not freedom. But some people think that that is freedom. They think that freedom of speech is simply to go and say whatever I want, irrespective of what that actually means and the implications of that speech and how it's going to affect others. Offensive speech is protected under freedom of speech. But somebody who masters the piano has become free now to play that instrument. They have an acquired freedom that enables them to do all the things that are possible to do on a piano. In fact, the highest level of musical mastery is certain pieces that are known. Like there's a certain piece by Rachmaninoff, who was a great Russian composer, that if you master that piece on the piano, you've really reached the end of the difficulties of that instrument. And there's also a piece in violin music that's famous for those who master it. In Zen archery, the average eighth dan Zen master gets his eighth dan between 70 and 80 years of age. That's how long it takes to master Zen archery. That's an acquired freedom. But the mind is shackled. The very nature of the mind is that we're born into the world with appetites that cloud our understanding, and also we have certain shackles that prevent us from thinking clearly. For instance, we generalize. If you go to New York and you take a taxi and have a Pakistani taxi driver and he cheats you, no offense to any Pakistani people, but then you get a second Pakistani taxi driver and he cheats you too, and suddenly all Pakistanis are cheats. This is how the mind works. It just generalizes quickly without any real basis for that generalization, because many, many taxi drivers who are Pakistani don't cheat. And so learning how to free the mind from the shackles of thought is what a liberal arts education is about. It's an acquired freedom to think freely. We talk about freedom of expression, and yet, if you can't think freely, how can you express yourself freely? So the idea is simply that I can speak and say whatever I want. This is not true freedom of speech. True freedom of speech is to be able to think freely without these shackles that prevent us from fulfilling the end of what a human being is, which is a being of reason, a being that does things for a purpose, for a reasonable purpose. And so this is a really important aspect, and this is why at the root of the Islamic civilization was the idea of the trivium. All of our scholars, without exception, were great grammarians, without exception, because grammar was the sine qua non of Islamic tradition. All of our great scholars were logicians. They were able to think and identify their terms. They had comportment in the way they spoke with others. And at the root of the Islamic education was persuasion, balagha. And this is why the great Quranic miracle is a persuasive miracle. It is the miracle of argument. The Quran is an argument. And if you read it as an argument, it either convinces you or it doesn't. But if you never even look at the argument and you reject it, you are not thinking freely. You are simply shackled by your prejudice. If you read the Quran, it's constantly telling people, don't they think? أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ Don't you use your intellects? إِنْهُمْ كَالْأَنْعَامِ They're living a bovine existence, eating and drinking and merriment. There's a profound seriousness in the Quran because life ultimately is serious despite the important moments of brevity. But in our culture, those moments of brevity have become the substance of our culture. Entertainment, comedians, news becomes comedy. Everything is reduced to a joke. Our Prophet ﷺ was a serious man. He had a light side. He told jokes. There's books on the humor of the Prophet ﷺ. He once said to a man needed a camel, and he said, I'll give you waradu, naq, I'll give you the baby camel. He said, what use is a baby camel to me? Walid, this is called tawriya in Arabic. It's a double entendre. Because anything, a grown camel is also the walid of another camel. But the first meaning is a baby camel. But it also means the child or the foal of a camel. And he said, isn't every camel the foal of another camel? He was telling a joke to the man. And there are many examples of this. There was a jester around the Prophet Nu'iman who used to make the Prophet ﷺ laugh. So our Prophet was not somebody who was somber. In fact, one of his names is Al-Dahak, the smiling one. He smiled a lot. But he's also Daimul Ahzan, a deeply contemplative person, somebody who was in profound meditation with his Lord. So we're here, hopefully, we've achieved what we set out to achieve by helping these young people free their minds to think better, to think more clearly, that they can go out in the world and do important things. We don't have any vocational training here. This is not from the Latin vocare, a calling. You have to find your own calling. This college is not here to determine what your calling is. It's here to teach you that when you find your calling, you're able to do it to the best of your ability. The liberal arts, which we call al-ulum al-aliyah, the instrumental arts or the arts of freedom, they won't save the world, but they do make the world worth saving. Thank you.
Iris, by Daniel Abdal-Hayy Moore. In the silence of the forest floor, a single iris rises. In the forests of the entire earth, we always find surprises. A light shaft from the redwood's peak, a dark bog full of frogs, white owls fluffing feathers, termites hollowing logs. Variety runs through us, joining elements in rings. There is a song of unity that choirs through all Earth's things. But we go beyond to where the song is elevated past our eyes. It's there the meaning comes, where all intentions rise. Beyond the heaviness of flesh, to show the reality of our acts, and in the next world's light supreme, in new light of the facts of our quick life. No dream but this one where we move, this one where we live and die. Then the world of pure light opens up, and into it we fly as we never flew before, through death's door.
Bismillah. I have the honor and privilege of introducing our commencement speaker, who has come all the way from the great city of Istanbul, what was formerly known as Constantinople. It's one of the great centers of civilization. And Dr. Recep, who I had the good fortune of meeting several years ago, is, I think, really one of the truly great visionaries in the Muslim community today. He's an indefatigable worker for the cause of harmony amongst civilizations. He's the head of a beautiful institution of higher education in Istanbul. Many of the things that they're doing there dovetail with what we're trying to do here. And it's a great honor and privilege that he's come this far to address us and taken his time, because I know he's one of the most busy people that I know. He has the unique vantage point of somebody who has mastered two civilizations. It's enough to master one civilization. Like Al-Mutanabbi said, مَا رَأَيْتُ نَقْصًا مِنْ عِيُوبَ النَّاسِ كَنَقْصَ الْقَادِرِينَ عَلَى التَّمَامِ. I've never seen a blemish worse than somebody's failure to complete the perfection of something. So to know two civilizations is quite an accomplishment. He is trained in the traditional Ottoman classical educational system, which was a liberal arts tradition that culminated in theology and law and medicine. But he's also a PhD from Columbia University in sociology and very well steeped in the humanities and social sciences of the West. So it's my sincere and grateful honor of introducing Dr. Recep Şentürk.
Esselamu aleyküm ve rahmetullahi ve berekatuhu. Euzubillahimineşşeytanirracim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Elhamdülillahi rabbil alemin. Ve salatu ve selamu ala rasulina وحبيبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب قلوبنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وإخوانه من الأنبياء والمرسلين أجمعين. I brought you salams of your brothers and sisters in Istanbul from sister institutions, and we are working for the same cause. I have had the honor to deliver many lectures around the world in prestigious academic institutions, but none of them have made me as happy and honored than this lecture here at Zaytuna College, because Zaytuna is very dear to my heart, and I see it as our hope for rebuilding Islam as an open civilization in America and the world, under the leadership of my dear colleague, brother, and friend, Hamza Yusuf and Zaid Şakir. Zaytuna College is an enlightening tree. It is an enlightening tree of a knowledge whose light comes neither from east nor from west, but directly from the divine light bestowed by Allah upon humanity through his beloved messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and transmitted to us by an unbroken chain of scholars and saints for 15 centuries until today, without any corruption. Zaytuna graduates constitute the last link of this golden chain of scholars and saints, and they will transmit the sacred trust they inherited from their teachers to their students, with the purpose of extending this chain of transmission to many centuries to come without compromising its reliability and authenticity. I stand here to convey you the message that Islam is an open civilization built upon two fundamental principles: multiplexity and universal humanism. In Arabic, maratib and adamiyya. But Muslims forgot these two principles under the influence of modernism and postmodernism, and deviated from the open civilization tradition in Islam. I stand here to call you to correct this error and work towards reviving Islam as an open civilization by reviving its two fundamental principles, multiplexity and adamiyya. Today, Islam is a fast-growing religion, if not the fastest-growing religion in the world. It is now the second religion in Europe and in America. Just recently, a Muslim has become the mayor of London. Prior to this, the mayor of Amsterdam was also a Muslim. It's commonly known that Muslims are now in the US Senate and House of Representatives in America. Islam is spreading fast in Africa, Japan, Russia, as well as in other parts of the world. This makes people wonder what will be the result and the implications. Non-Muslims rightfully ask, what would Muslims do if they gain power? What would humanity gain or lose with the spread of Islam? Those who criticize Islam try to convince the world at large that Muslims will terrorize the whole world. We as Muslims should ask the same question to ourselves. What's our future vision for Islamic civilization and the whole world? What's our promise to humanity? The Muslim youth is waiting answers for these questions. By asking these questions, I reflect the quest of the world public opinion and the Muslim youth. But also, I change the conventional questions Muslims have been asking for the last two centuries. What has the world lost with the fall of Islam? This is the title of a famous book by Abu'l-Hasan al-Nadwi. I change this question and ask, what would the world gain with the spread of Islam and the rise of Islamic civilization? Likewise, Muslims have been asking for the last two centuries, what should we take from the West? The question I propose is rather different. What can we give to the West and to the humanity? My answer to these questions is very simple: open civilization. Our future vision of Islam is an open civilization. As Muslims, our promise to humanity is to be an open civilization. Humanity will gain open civilization with the flourishing Islam. But what's open civilization, and why should we call Islam an open civilization? I divide civilizations into two categories: open civilizations and closed civilizations. By open civilization, I mean a civilization which acknowledges the existence of other civilizations and tries to build peaceful relations with them and find ways to coexist with them. In contrast, a closed civilization sees itself as the only civilization in the world and tries to eliminate other civilizations. From this perspective, Islam is an open civilization. This is how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam built Islam from the very beginning in Medina. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught to his companions that Islam is the true religion, but not the only religion in the world. This is evident in the constitution of Medina, which brought together Muslims and non-Muslims as citizens of a state, and he built consensus among these citizens. And Prophet Muhammad granted human rights to non-Muslims who denied that he was the messenger of Allah. They denied that Quran is the book of Allah, but he still granted them freedom of religion. Yet at that time, during Middle Ages, most of the other civilizations in the world were closed civilizations, from China to India, from Iran to Europe. Then the pressing question is, why was Islam an open civilization during the Middle Ages when all other civilizations were closed civilizations? What made Prophet Muhammad give freedom to people who thought that he was not a true messenger of God? And what made Islam give freedom to people who denied Islam as a religion of Allah? Our fuqaha, our ulama, answers this question as follows. They say that the purpose of Islamic polity, Islamic law, is to help realize Allah's purpose in creating humanity. So what's the purpose of Allah in creating humanity? It is to test them, to try them. And a true test can take place only if everyone is free when they take this test. They must have the freedom to err or to answer in a correct way. So the purpose of Islamic political system, legal system, is not to impose Islam on other people, but to create the environment, free environment of test. And this is needed so that the existence of paradise and hellfire also makes sense, because paradise is a reward for people who choose to do the right thing, although they had the possibility and freedom of doing the wrong thing. And hellfire is a punishment for people who did the wrong thing, although they had the possibility and freedom of doing the right thing. So the purpose of Islamic political system, legal system, is to achieve God's purpose in creating humanity, which is a true and genuine test. As I mentioned about Islam as an open civilization, has been built upon two pillars: multiplexity and Adamiyya. Let me explain what's meant by these two principles. Multiplexity is the philosophical and conceptual foundation of open civilization, and Adamiyya, which is the universal humanism, is the foundation of Islamic legal system. Multiplexity reflects itself in several areas. First, in our approach to existence. We accept that there is material worlds and there is non-material worlds and also divine worlds. These are different levels of existence, which I call multiplex ontology. Traditionally, it was called maratibul vücud. Similar to this, there is a multiplex epistemology which was called maratibul ulum. Every level of existence requires a special epistemology for this particular level of existence. That's why Islamically we accept that there are multiple levels of knowledge which utilizes reason, sense perception, revelation, and ma'rifah or irfan, experiential knowledge derived through kashf. And corresponding to these levels of existence and levels of knowledge, there are multiple levels of methodology, which I call multiplex methodology. Traditionally, it was called maratibul usul. It incorporates rational methods, empirical methods, and interpretive methods, as well as spiritual methods. Similar to this, our interpretive system accepts multiplex hermeneutics, which was called maratibul ma'ani. A text has external meaning, internal meaning, and also meaning of meaning. So this is a very interesting term. Muslims invented meaning of meaning. Let me explain it to you with an example. So if somebody knocks the door and the person inside says there is no one inside, what's the meaning of this? So the meaning of it is that I don't want you to come in. But you cannot get this meaning simply by looking at the sentence itself. So this is the meaning of meaning. And again, similar to this, there is a norm, a multiplex normative system, which is expressed in maratibul ahkam. According to fuqaha in general, there is five norms which may be attached to an action, and according to the Hanafi school, nine norms, nine values, normative values, may be attached to the action of a human being. So our normative system did not work using a binary logic, which is based on right and wrong. We have fard and haram, and in between, makruh tahriman, makruh tanzihan, mustahab, mandub, sunnah muakkada, sunnah ghayr muakkada, and wajib. So it employs a multi-valued logic rather than a binary logic, which is used presently in modern law and morality. And this leads us to maratibul haqaiq, multiplex truth, that truth has multiple levels. And there is at one level absolute truth, at another level relative truth. And in order for people to understand this, they go through an education which has degrees, and their heart goes through transformations. Modern psychology takes human psychology as something static, but according to Islamic psychology in tasawwuf, human psychology, the heart goes through transformations from nafs ammara to nafs lawwama, to nafs mulhima, to nafs mutmainna. So in Arabic, they translate psychology as ilm al-nafs. And when I meet my colleagues, Arab colleagues, and when they say, I study ilm al-nafs, I ask them, which nafs you study? A multiplex system of thought uses multi-valued logic rather than binary logic. It is the conceptual foundation of open civilization because it forestalls reductionism and relativism. Materialism and idealism are two forms of Western reductionism. Yet in multiplex worldview, material and ideal reality constitute two different levels of existence. Modernism emphasized unity and single universal truth, while postmodernism emphasized diversity and relativism. However, multiplexity allows accommodating different views at different levels without falling into reductionism and relativism. Therefore, it's a better strategy for diversity management than postmodernity. When we look at the Islamic intellectual history, I see three periods. The classical period, which was completely characterized by multiplex thought. Then in the 20th century, there was a very tense clash between unilayered worldview based on materialism, reductionist, using a positivist understanding of existence, knowledge, and methodology with the multiplex traditional Islamic worldview. And we Muslims, because of our love for modernism and modernization, abandoned such a sophisticated worldview and abandoned and adopted reductionist, positivist worldview. And now we are in the 21st century. I think that it's a time for us to critically examine what we did, whether it was right or wrong. And I believe that we did wrong choices, our civilization went into wrong direction, and it deviated from this multiplex thinking to a unilayered thought. And the second foundation of open civilization is Adamiyya. It comes from the term, the word Adam. Adamiyya means Adamness or Adamhood, which I translate as universal humanism, because it's a concept used in Islamic law. This term is the legal and moral foundation of open civilization. In contrast, secularist and religious nationalism and racism are the legal and moral foundations of closed civilizations. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam made Adamiyya, universal humanism, the foundation of Islamic legal, moral, political, and ethical system. Later, Fuqaha formulated it as a legal maxim, and it is stated that al-isma bil-adamiyya, which means inviolability is due for humanity. This legal maxim grants inviolability of human rights to every human being, regardless of his or her nationality, religion, gender, race, color, and wealth, simply because he or she is a human being. And these rights are enforced by the legal system. It covers inviolability of life, property, religion, mind, honor, and family. When it says inviolability of religion, it is not only Islam, but all religion. When it says life, it is not the lives of Muslims, but the lives of all Adamis, all human beings. So the terms used in our tradition for universal human rights include the following. Hukuk al-Adamiyin, rights of the Adamis. Hurmat al-Adamiyin, inviolability of human beings. Kulliyat, which means universal rights. And daruriyat, which means necessary, indispensable, inalienable rights. These are the terms used in our classical law books. And this idea was not a utopia. It was implemented first by Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself in Medina, later by the Umayyads, Abbasids, Ottomans in Andalusia, and in India under the Baburs or Mughals. Among all these examples, the most interesting one to show the universality of Islamic law and the universalism of Islamic law is the Islamic rule in India. Because in India, Muslims ruled Hindus and Buddhists, and they granted them the same rights they granted to Christians and Jews in other parts of the world. Today, it is commonly known that Muslims accept Abrahamic religions, but it is less known that Muslims grant the same rights granted to Christians and Jews under Islamic rule to non-Ahli Kitab. And today, non-Ahli Kitab people constitute 45% of the world population. And we have to explain to them that because they are Adamis, we respect them. This is part of our law. But when we look at the Islamic history, we see that in the classical period, this principle was implemented. And Ottomans institutionalized it as millet system. There is Jewish millet, Orthodox millet, Armenian millet, later Protestants and Catholics were also given the status of millet. They were free in their internal affairs. And in 19th century, second half of the 19th century, some reforms took place under the late Ottoman caliphs. They abolished slavery in 1847. They abolished dhimmi status and the jizya tax in 1856. They adopted constitutional system in 1876. And they also adopted parliamentary system, and they had several multi-party elections. And all these things took place by the advice of ulama, the Ottoman ulama and the Sheikh al-Islam under the Khalifa. But when nation-state models were adopted by Muslims after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, Muslims abandoned the concept of Adamiyya and universal humanism of Islam. They adopted nationalist ideologies and they justified it either through secularist or Islamic terms. The 20th century is the century of westernization and modernization in the Muslim world. As a result, Muslims adopted closed civilization model based on nationalism all over the Muslim world. In reaction, another ideological position emerged, which advocated protection of the rights of Muslims alone. This was a deviation from the universalist tradition of Islam. Both positions, whether secular nationalism or Islamic nationalism, represent a clear deviation from the open civilization tradition in Islam. And finally, where do we go from here? Now I see the signs of the fourth period, a new period, which is characterized with a call to open civilization. It's high time to call to end the deviation from the Islamic open civilization. How can we revive Islam as an open civilization once again? We need to do two things. First, revive multiplex worldview, maratib. Second, revive the concept of Adamiyya as the foundation of Islamic social thought. Today, Muslims forgot the multiplexity and Adamiyya doctrine. We disowned our heritage, the Adamiyya paradigm, and the multiplex worldview. We need to reclaim this legacy as an alternative to what modernists and postmodernists offer to us. We need to re-establish two principles of Islamic thought in our education. First, that the existence, knowledge, method, meaning, norms, and truth are multiplex. Second, every human being is inviolable for the sake of his or her humanity. These are the two foundations of our open civilization. It is based on unity in multiplexity. I'm not saying unity in diversity. I am saying unity in multiplexity because there is a maratib. If you want to revive Islamic civilization, we need to revive the Islamic worldview and knowledge. This cannot be achieved without reviving Islamic education. Open civilization today is no longer a choice. It's a necessity, and we need to reconfigure everything we do and all our institutions accordingly. This is needed to adjust ourselves to the present and to prepare ourselves for the future. I see that Zaytuna College is playing a major role in educating Muslims and non-Muslims in leading their way towards reviving open civilization in America. Reviving Islam as an open civilization is a dream. You may also call it a utopia. Karl Mannheim, however, the famous sociologist, in his book titled Utopia, says that the social change comes only from utopia. You need a utopia to create social change. We need a dream to bring about social change along with Islamic lines. This dream must derive from the Quran, from the Sunnah, and from the dream of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It should be a revival of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's dream about his ummah and humanity. It is his dream which created a great change, in human history. We need it again to create another change, to save our planet and the world from the problems caused by closed civilizations and the misinterpretation of Islam as a closed civilization. We need this vision, this dream, or the utopia for two reasons. First, to offer it to our youth and the ummah as a future goal around which we can unite and mobilize the whole ummah. Otherwise, false visions will fill the vacuum and mislead our youth, as you are regrettably witnessing today. Second, to tell humanity, outside observers, and the bystanders what we aim for the future, what contribution we plan to make to the world, what we promise to humanity, be they Muslims and non-Muslims, be they Ahl Kitab or non-Ahl Kitab. In conclusion, I would like to repeat that it's my dream to revive Islam as an open civilization, and this is the dream we inherited from Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, based on multiplex view and Adamiya concept, and I am here to call you to share this dream with me. Zaytuna graduates should leave Zaytuna not only with the knowledge of Islam, but also with a dream for the future of Islam. I am here to offer you this dream. Yet, you should always keep in mind that the only way to realize your dream is to wake up and work. Before I end, I would like to advise to the graduates of Zaytuna to continue combining their traditional and modern studies until they truly become a true scholar, an alim, to lead their communities, the ummah, and the humanity in the right path. I leave you with three key words to keep in mind. You can forget everything, just remember these three words: open civilization, multiplexity, and Adamiyya. Thank you, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Now introduce Mohammad Khan, who's going to give some remarks for the students. Thank you.
In alhamdulillah, hamdan yuwafi ni'mahu wa yukafi'u mazida wa qur rabbi zidni ilman wa amalan salihan. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق وعلى آله حق قدره ومقداره العظيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Thank you, Dr. Recep, Şentürk, for such a moving speech. I would also like to take the time to especially present my heartfelt love for the wonderful donors who have built this institution and have allowed for all of us to graduate with an exceptional education, debt-free. This I would like to really highlight because I came here with only $100 in my pocket. And today, I stand before you, grateful, humbled, and most importantly, debt-free. I would like to also extend my love to the distinguished scholars, board of trustees, esteemed faculty, and most importantly, our beloved co-founders, Sheikh Hamza, Imam Zaid, and Dr. Hatim, all of whom have worked tirelessly to make this institution into the fine college you see before you. Today is a time of reflection over the past and a time of optimism for the future. It is said that if you are sad, you are living in the past, and if you are anxious, then you are living in the future. And if you are at peace, you are living in the moment. And so I would like to take the time to address this very moment of peace. Before coming to Zaytuna College, I did not feel a true sense of belonging in either my Muslim or American identity. Although I enjoyed my study of biology, I did not find the meaning and intellectual enrichment I was yearning for. And so I came to Zaytuna in the hopes of discovering principles by which my understanding of the self and the world could reflect a higher truth. Knowledge of spiritual principles changed my existential question from what is my identity to what does it mean to be a human, a creature endowed and composed of both physical and metaphysical realities. Knowledge of these principles gave me the moral conviction, intellectual fortitude, and spiritual strength to finally realize and truly become an American Muslim. My journey at Zaytuna was certainly not free of difficulties and shortcomings. The companions I have made at Zaytuna have been a great means of support and assistance. And if I am to be honest, I would not be here today had it not been for their continuous aid and undying love. Aisha, I want to thank you for teaching me the work ethic that is demanded of a true student. Rima, I admire you for your commitment in promoting the rights of women with the prophetic spirit. Madeeha, you taught me the value and virtue of patience in the face of trying times. Sidra, your love for the Arabic language has been a real source of inspiration. Nadia and Wafa, or as we lovingly refer to them as, the Najjar sisters, you have always exemplified the value of modesty. John, the love and dedication you have for the Arabic language shows in the progress you have made in such a little time, and we all can take lessons from it. Hamad Khan, one third of the conspiracy, your continued emphasis on Islamic spirituality has given me many spiritual insights. Ahmed Gul, I have seen exponential growth in you, not just in your size, but your level of maturity and fortitude has become the standard by which I have come to assess myself with. I say here today, it has been a great honor learning from your character for the last 4.5 years. Omar B., I love you for the sake of Allah. The two of us have spent many all-nighters studying for Ustad Abdullah's exams. In those late nights, the two of us showed each other our hearts. I do not know how black mine was, but yours shined like the summer sun. I am humbled by your strength, and I'm honored by your presence here today. Honestly, before I came to Zaytuna, I did not know how to articulate myself properly, write properly, spell properly, dress properly, and above all that, I had never read a book in my life. Zaytuna has exceptionally facilitated my development in all of these regards, and most importantly, it has given me the confidence to pick up any book and learn for myself any subject I so desire. I would like to once again wholeheartedly thank the co-founders, Sheikh Hamza, Imam Zaid, and Dr. Hatim, for giving me the privilege of attending Zaytuna College. I would like to thank Dr. Mahan Mirza and Dr. Cindy Osik for their exceptional and consistent contributions to the development of Zaytuna College. I would also like to thank Sheikh Abdullah Ali, Dr. Delp, Sheikh Faraz Khan, Dr. Fadi El-Hin, Dr. Colleen Keyes, and Imam Bilal for being foundational in my intellectual and spiritual growth. I would also like to express my gratefulness to Imam Dawood for instilling in me the importance of community engagement and community service. I would like to express my deepest regards for my aunt, Nadira Latif, and my cousin, Subhat Khwaja. Who instilled in me the confidence to come to Zaytuna College. I would especially like to present my utmost gratitude for my mother, father, and my sister, who have raised me with all the love the world has to offer and with all the prayers one can ever ask for. There have been times where every molecule in my body felt that I had failed an exam, but because my mother hit the mat and raised her hands, God elevated my grades to the highest of ranks. I would also like to express my love for the one who left her life, family, and career to be with me and to open for me the capacity to stand here before you. My beautiful, loving wife. Her father, Sheikh Atiqur Rahman Barakat, the man who trusted me with his daughter only on the supposition that I have the Qur'an in my heart despite not having anything in my pocket at the time. Most importantly, I want to thank God who by his grace and wisdom put all these incredible people in my life so that I may, through their tutelage, serve his creation. It is important that we all understand and reflect on the centrality of God in all of our affairs, and truly all praise belongs solely to him. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala sayyidina mursaleen. Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ahlihi wa ashabi ajma'in. After that beautiful speech, I think I'll begin mine with a thanks to Muhammad for thanking everyone, because we know that we're here through the fadl of Allah, through the grace that he gives us to be a community, through the vision and the love of our founders, through the board of trustees that guides us, through the faculty who work very hard. This faculty works very hard to produce these students. We've only produced, now today, it will total 24, but 24 students, graduates, hopefully someday scholars, who will go forth into the world to do the work of God. That's what you've been called to do. That's why you're here. That's why God put you here. And how did he do it? God did this because he has blessed our founders. He's blessed our faculty. He's blessed all of us who work here at Zaytuna. He's put us here in this time and in this place to be a community of learning so that we can do his work. And as Dr. Recep Şentürk just said, there's a dream, but we have to wake up from the dream and work. And our donors, our givers, donors mean givers. The donors who support this endeavor, who support the work of the faculty, who help so that these students can grow as human beings and as students. God gave them what he has given them to help us to be here today. And I'm looking out, I've been looking through the crowd as our various speakers have come up, and I have seen almost every single one of you before. And then I think about, besides all of you who I've seen before, our students and our former students and our graduates and You know, we thank Mehdi Amin, for one of our graduates, for providing the beautiful song that we marched into. And there are so many people here who are donors and supporters who have given, whether a dollar or a dua, as I always say, the duas we appreciate. We need your duas as much as the dollars. We need your duas. And our donors who are not here today, the donors who have made this possible, the donors who have given from their hard-earned money, they could have done other things with it, but they gave it to this endeavor. And so we have a responsibility. Students are here to learn their tradition, to learn the Western tradition, the Islamic tradition. They're here to learn respect for difference, how to take responsibility for themselves, and how to lead. And we're here because Allah has made it possible through our donors and all those who support us. And so we say thank you, and I ask all of you now to bow your head and make a dua to Allah to bless all who work here, who support this in any way. Bow your head and ask God to bless them and to bless our work.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. By the authority of the Board of Trustees and with the recommendation of the faculty, Zaytuna College hereby confers the Bachelor of Arts degrees on the class of 2016. So now we're going to give the diplomas to our graduates.
I now present the graduates in alphabetical order. Our first two graduates are sisters who are native to the Bay Area. Nadia and Wafa An-Najjar started the program together along with their third sister, Ghana, who will graduate next year, inshallah. All three were accepted to the prestigious Near Eastern Studies program at UC Berkeley, but they chose to attend Zaytuna. Nadia and Wafa collaborated on their senior thesis, which is a translation and analysis of the second part of At-Tuhfa As-Saniya, The Glowing Gift, a commentary of a classical treatise on Arabic grammar by Ibn Ajurrum. After Zaytuna, Nadia hopes to continue her studies in religion, and Wafa intends to pursue a career as a medical practitioner. Always seen together, often visiting office hours together, commuting from their home together, collaborating on research, and now commencing together. First, from Richmond, California, Nadia An-Najjar. Also from Richmond, California, Wafa An-Najjar. Our next graduate never had to try. All he had to do was be. Omar B. A lover of science, a bundle of joy, always found studying in the exact same chair, in the exact same spot. Omar Beramoglu's energy and smile are hard to match, and his adab impeccable. When not lost in the world of quantum physics and artificial intelligence, he would be engaged in service, organizing community-wide gatherings for the remembrance of God. After graduating, Omar B. will be joining Hartford Seminary's graduate program in Islamic chaplaincy. From Paterson, New Jersey, Omar Beyramoglu. Aisha Darab is a gifted student, one who, with tawfiq from Allah, is destined to surpass many of her teachers. An intelligent and spirited individual, Aisha spearheaded the establishment of the student council in her junior year and became one of the youngest students to complete her clinical pastoral education for chaplaincy at UCSF Hospital last summer. She will be moving to Santa Fe with her philosopher king spouse to start a graduate program in the Western Classics. She was told by the Office of Admissions at St. John's College that hers was perhaps one of the strongest applications the college has seen in the past decade. Graduating with highest honors, summa cum laude, from Vienna, Virginia, Aisha Darab. With Gohar in her name, it was only fitting for Madeeha to find her calling in Zaytuna's courses in logic and philosophy. Gohar being a variant of Jauhar, meaning essence or substance. Madeeha is one of those students who never complains. Driven, determined, dedicated. A gem of a soul, gem being another meaning of her name. Madeeha's love of learning brought her to Zaytuna after already having completed a BA in political science along with an MBA. At Zaytuna, her journey into the life of the mind led her to a thesis on the process of abstraction in the thought of Imam al-Ghazali and Thomas Aquinas. After graduating, she is moving back to her hometown, taking a position at the UC Davis Medical Center as resident chaplain. Graduating with honors, cum laude, from Sacramento, Madeeha Gohar. There are some students who come to Zaytuna as boys and leave as men. Ahmed Gul is now a member of that elite category, entering as a bud and exiting as a flower. In his case, literally, because Gul means rose or flower. In his senior year, Ahmed served as the class representative for his cohort, advocating on their behalf for extensions, relaxation of graduation or course requirements, always with a smile and in good cheer, so the deans never knew what hit them. In his ethics class, Ahmed engaged Sam Harris's thesis on predestination. He extended his research in the senior thesis by taking on the thorny subject of free will and moral responsibility. After graduation, he will begin taking prerequisites towards a career in medicine, specializing in cardiology. From Lompoc, California, Ahmed Gul. Hafiz Muhammad Khan, whom you may have heard reciting the Qur'an at our events or in prayer, may be described as creative, systematic, and rigorous. A close reader of texts, analytic thinker, and practitioner, Muhammad used his experiential learning requirement as an opportunity to apply a novel phonetic approach to teaching tajweed to native speakers of English. His thesis on the development of Greco-Arabic medicine highlights the holistic nature of traditional medicine by tracing the connections between Plato's concept of the soul and the cardinal virtues, Aristotelian theory of the elements, Galen's theory of the humors, and Avicenna's synthesis of the Hellenistic tradition, contrasting it with the fragmented clinical approaches in contemporary science and medicine. The paper was received with high praise by the faculty in their retreat last week. After graduation, Mohammad will be pursuing a career in clinical mental health, graduating with highest honors, summa cum laude, from Houston, Texas, Mohammad Khan. President of the Student Council this year, tall yet soft-spoken, Hamad Khan is best described as a gentle giant. All heart, Hamad is a man in touch with himself and his purpose. I first met him 5 years ago, about a year before he enrolled at Zaytuna, dressed in a Pakistani sherwani, looking like Neo from The Matrix. Like the one from that movie, we pray, according to the prophetic prayer, that Hamad is blessed with basira, as one who has the ability to see things as they are. His thesis on the Mohammedan light is a reflection on the distinction and interplay between different levels of reality. Alas, with the commencement of Mohammed Khan and Hamad Khan this year, and last year of his brother Adil Khan, the era of a Khan-spiracy at Zaytuna College now draws to a close, signifying the end of an era and the beginning of another. From Los Angeles, California, Hamad Gul Khan. My fondest memories of Rima will be her visits to office hours. I recall many afternoons at Hillegas when Rima's voice could be heard getting closer and closer as she popped into the office of one instructor after another. The best part was that her visits were never without purpose, always targeting questions on the readings or lectures. Focused and motivated, Rima took additional courses during her summer vacations in areas of her interest: law, society, politics, gender. Her memorable papers include a critical analysis of an Islamophobic article published by Fox News, where she broke the arguments down into syllogisms to expose their absurdity, and a creative paper in the form of a Platonic dialogue between Kant and Aristotle, who visits him in a dream. Rima Latif will become Zaytuna's first student to go on to law school, starting this fall at the University of Illinois. From Orlando, Florida, Rima Latif. Our last two graduates, like the first two, hail from the Bay Area. Both finished the program at Zaytuna in 3 years. Both came from unconventional backgrounds, Sidra having studied for 10 years in Syria and fluent in Arabic, and John having completed his undergraduate work at St. John's College in Santa Fe and Annapolis. Both Sidra and John have also accomplished landmark firsts. Sidra wrote her senior thesis in Arabic, and John publicly defended his thesis in an oral examination conducted by Dr. Colleen Keyes and his thesis advisor, Dr. Mark Delp, yesterday evening. Sidra is also the first and only student to graduate or to complete Zaytuna's challenging program, honors program, which is led by Ustaz Faraz Khan. The program includes expanded memorization in the Qur'an and memorization of several texts, including the Jawharat al-Tawheed in theology, the Arba'in al-Nawawi, the Bayquniya in hadith, Kifayat al-Ghulam in fiqh, the Mutun of Zubad and Murshid al-Mu'in in tasawwuf. This is a tremendous achievement and great honor. And you will see with the special sash that she wears, it has a sandal of the Prophet in recognition of this achievement. Sidra will be going on to pursue graduate work in the United Arab Emirates at the University of Sharjah in Islamic Law. How fitting, since she was born a Qazi, graduating with honors and in addition from the honors program, cum laude from Fremont, California, Sidra Qazi. I made reference to John earlier as philosopher king. That was not a joke. At Zaytuna, he led a philosophy club for multiple years, reading texts of Plato and Aristotle, Ibn Sina and Farabi, while mentoring other students. My conversations with him on the curriculum were deeply enriching for me, and for that, I am truly grateful. John, after graduation, will be engaged in private study in preparation for a PhD in Islamic studies. And our prayer is for him, as it is for all of our students, that they surpass their teachers in scholarship and service by the grace of God. Graduating with honors, cum laude, from Fremont, California, John Ropoulos. Will the graduates please rise? Ladies and gentlemen, the class of 2016.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidil Mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammad. Wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Rabbana laka alhamd. Kama yanbaghi li jalali wajhik wa li azimi sultanik. Subhanaka la nuhsi thanaan alayka anta kama athnayta ala nafsik. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim tasliman kathira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We'd like to once again thank all of you here today who have supported this college over the years. Your prayers, your sacrifices, your hard-earned money in many instances. And as we mentioned yesterday, some of you who have supported this college by offering, in worldly terms, the greatest donation you could possibly give to it, that of your children, entrusting us with their future. We'd like to thank our fellow founders who have sacrificed aspects of their careers, faculty, again, who all, based on their credentials, PhDs from Notre Dame, from Yale, from Stanford, here UC Berkeley, formerly Cornell University, Exeter, could be anywhere, teaching at any university, but have sacrificed to be here. Our staff, who work tirelessly, multitasking, inevitably, many instances underpaid, but always overachieving. May Allah Ta'ala bless them, may Allah Ta'ala bless you. As we conclude with a prayer, I wish I had a prayer that could solve the problems of the world. I wish I had a prayer that could remove the rancor, bitterness, the animosity that exists in the hearts of many human beings. I wish I had a magical prayer, but at the end of the day, it's not the power or the magic of the prayer. It's the magnanimity of our Lord. It's the power of our Lord that affects things in His creation. So we pray with Him and we pray to Him. And we pray that our prayer meets that moment of acceptance and that our prayer is acceptable to Him. We pray that all of these wonderful young people, and you've been given brief glimpses into their life and their character, we pray that they're all blessed with courage as they go out into the world to meet the many daunting, seemingly insurmountable challenges that await them. But with courage, and most especially the courage to believe that with God, with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any challenge in this world can be overcome. Any obstacle can be surmounted. Any hard, steep, difficult path can be made smooth. We pray that Allah blesses them with courage to believe and to trust and to forge on despite the difficulties. We pray that Allah Ta'ala, Almighty God, blesses them to be just, to appreciate and to value justice, to work tirelessly for justice in all of their affairs, and to couple those seeds of leadership potential that possibly have begun to sprout forth during their time here, to couple those fledgling glimpses of leadership with justice, because one without the other is insufficient. We pray that Allah Ta'ala, Almighty God, blesses them with temperance, with the ability to discipline themselves, to restrain themselves, and especially those lower forms of that multi layered, multiplexical nafs that both Dr. Mahan and Dr. Rajab were alluding to restrain it, not to give in to its temptations. And when all about them, those are losing their head because of it, that they are the ones who are known for their restraint. They are the ones known for their moderation. They are the ones who are known for their prudence. They are the ones who are keeping their heads. And finally, we pray that Almighty God, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses them with wisdom. With wisdom to know when to go forward, pushed by the sometimes intemperate winds or the irrational demands of courage, and when to move back and to pull back and to stand down, understanding that doing so is not a sign of cowardice. We pray that they have the wisdom to understand and to recognize when justice must be tempered by fairness, and to not become blind advocates of justice, impassioned and enraged, forgetting all of the restraints that fairness calls for. For justice without fairness can devolve into folly. We pray that they have the wisdom to understand and to recognize when it is indeed virtuous to restrain oneself, and when one must fight the urges to be restrained and to stand up and to speak a timely word, or to engage in a timely action, or to give birth to a timely thought. May our prayer be answered. May their prayers be answered. May your prayers be answered by a mighty, gracious, merciful Lord. Ameen, ameen, ameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Allahu, 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 Allah, Allahu, Allah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu, 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 Allah, Allahu, Allah, Allahu, Allahu, Allahu.
Allahu Allah, la ilaha illa Allah. Fa ya Rabbi salli ala al-Mustafa, salatan barik biha kulliyat zaytuna. Allahu 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 Allah Allahu Allah la ilaha illa Allah fa ya rabbi salli ala al-mustafa salatan waffiq biha kulliyat zaytuna Allahu 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 Allah Allahu Allah la ilaha illa Allah fa ya rabbi salli ala al-mustafa salatan ihfaz biha kulliyat zaytuna Allahu 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 Allah Allahu Allah la ilaha illa Allah.
Thank you for being a sustainer of Zaytuna College as a member of 12,000 Strong. Tell your friends and family about the benefits of supporting America's first Muslim liberal arts college.